into your heart and mind. We should always have that smile on. You remember that old Bible school campfire, Sunday school songs? You know, we were supposed to have a, if you know the Jesus, you're supposed to let the world know it by smiling or something like that. So I'm just asking you today to just smile just a little bit if you can. And just want to go over that tractor Sunday thing again. If you would pay a little attention with me, just going over it again. And Jeff, you did a fine job. We did do some modifications. We added the fill a bucket advertisement, which we had ongoing, but it's in Word. Just want to make sure that it's in your mind and you're out shopping. You grab a few cans of this and that. Last year we were able to fill the buckets up, and it was a pretty good program. So. Grab a tractor, grab your garden tractor, grab whatever it has with wheels. If you think it looks like a tractor, we've got some tractors coming, I know that. And I'd like to see it be a wonderful gathering. So we are going to be eventually making our way to the parking lot and then back down to the Tom Jack Park as a group. There is room down at the bottom of the hill, Linda and Tim's, if you should need to park something there ahead of time. I may be considering that. I don't know about Leona yet. I may be at Leona. I may not be. I haven't been able to talk with Jody. But if that's the case, then I would park my tractor there. But that's an option for you, because I already talked with them earlier about that. And then we're going to have the service at the Tom Jack Pavilion. Everything right there. And as we've said before, there's always that concern with mask wearing and everything. And some aren't in the pews because of that, but if you're out in the open air and you keep your distance and let the wind blow around you, and you might feel just a bit more comfortable out in the open, that'll be an opportunity for you next Sunday. And I encourage all of you to be a part of that. I just want it to be a wonderful fellowship, a wonderful reunion of believers, and just the tractors as they come in, and remember God's good blessing on the whole day. Certainly the barbecue chicken is an added plus, and I'm kind of lathering up for that already. So we do praise God for opportunities to get together, and some things in the wide open spaces, COVID-19 hasn't been able to injure it too badly. So Genesis 3, if you've noticed the printout there, and I always thank Tammy for the bulletin that she makes them for me. Genesis 3, right in the very beginning of everything. And we're going 1 through 19, okay? Just a little bit ahead of that is the creation and all the story associated with that. Man is created. Then we have the perfect garden, and then we begin to take a turn, okay? And we find ourselves with a serpent. And I want you to know, as we begin to read this, when the serpent tempted Eve, the serpent wasn't what we know as a serpent today, okay? He was a very beautiful creature, and no one exactly knows, but they do know that it isn't what it was, because as you read the scriptures, you'll find out what happened to the serpent as a result of his temptation. But let's pick it up here in the Garden of Eden, the serpent and Eve, and I've read this for years, and time and again, I'll kid with Tammy that it was the woman that started all this, and then we'll get going, you know, just for fun. And it's got to be fun. And now in Genesis 3, chapter 3, verse 1. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, "Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die. God has given a command." And the serpent said to the woman, "You shall not surely die." Here's where the wise begin, okay? "For God knows that in the day that you eat of it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Whenever you have something that you're looking at that you don't know or you haven't got in your hand, the temptation is to see what that is that you're being prevented from. Verse 6, "So when the woman saw the tree was good for food, was pleasant to the eyes and a tree desirable to make one wise. She took of its fruit and ate. She also gave it to her husband with her, and he ate. The eyes of both of them were open, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. Verse 8. Now, this is interesting to me. I mean, it's almost comical for them to think that they could hide from God. Impossible. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But you can't hide from God. That's another old song. He knows. And the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, "Where are you?" So he plays along. You know, God does. So he said, "I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." Verse 11, he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree which I commanded you that you should not eat?" And the man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I ate." He's quick to blame the woman, isn't he? Then he gets caught. And the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" And the woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." Now we're going to flip the gears here a little bit, and we're going to see how the Lord deals with this serpent as a result of what he has done. So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, you are cursed more than all cattle, more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed, and he shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." So far as I know, any snake I've ever seen still crawls around today. But remember, they didn't always look like that. At one time, it was a very beautiful creature. We can only imagine what it would have taken to beguile Eve. And if you look up there in verse 15, at the very last part of it, about the bruising of the head and the bruising of the heel, if you go into that and a little more depth, which we don't have time today, but if you study it and read some commentary on it as they pull those verses apart, that's the earliest form of reference you have that there will be a way out of this. God knew. Satan may bruise his heel, but Jesus will bruise his head. To the woman he said, "I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In pain you will bring forth children. Your desire will be for your husband, and he shall rule over you." And to Adam he said, "Because you have heeded the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree of which I commanded you, saying, 'You shall not eat of it,' cursed is the ground for your sake. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life." And I had to stop and think about that. Me and I work the soil. If I just go out and sit down somewhere, I've never seen a crop of anything except for weeds come up. And then you go on a little further, "Both thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the herb of the field." And if you leave any piece of ground for any length of time, first thing that appears, vineberry bushes and thistles and all kinds of sharp, spindly things. Leave it a little longer, and you've got thorn apples. When we first bought the farm that we live on, that particular place, he hadn't run cows in the pasture for 10 or 12 years, and already we had knee-high thorn apple bushes. All kinds of things. We had to mow and bush out and mow some more. If it's not kept up, in the last verse here, "In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread until you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and to the dust you will return." And if we just want to wander over to those single verse readings there that we have, go to Matthew 6, or 16. And it's verse 6 is the one we're going to read there. 16:6. "And Jesus said to them, 'Take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees.'" Now just a little bit of leaven goes a long way. Just a very little bit. And that's why the Feast of the Unleavened Bread that the Jews have in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 6. "Your glory is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump?" In other words, anything that's not good, even just a little bit, can create a whole lot of bad. But in reverse, just a little bit of good can go and expand and create a whole lot of good. And that's kind of what we're after today as we commence on the morning message here. But shall we bow our heads for a word of prayer? Father, as we gather again, there is a reason. We come here to praise your holy name, to celebrate what you've done for us, to fellowship with other believers as you've commanded us, to take some orders and receive the call of the well as you've told us what we should do. But we need to study your word. And the only way we can effectively study your word is through the power of your Holy Spirit. Help us to open our minds and tune our hearts. Open wide our souls to receive that power that can only be had as we read your word through the inspiration of your Spirit. Walk with us today as we consider it, and help us to go away with new armament to be able to go out and fight off the evil that lurks in our world today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Summertime. It's a hot summer. It's not the hottest I've ever seen, but compared to last year, this is a lot hotter. It was hard to break 80 last year. Of course, a lot of rain, a lot of clouds, a lot of storms. And there's a lot of things that aren't happening this summer that normally would have happened starting back even in the spring, as we all know. Or if they did happen, they're in a greatly altered condition. Last night, Zachary said to me, he says, well, Joy Fair is over. And I said, well, Joy Fair never was, but if it were, it would be over. Just that quick. Time just flies. Something about it, you look at the calendar and you say, well, this would be that, and that would be that, and then you look at it again, and it's over. 2020 is rapidly moving along. August, summer is still here, but summer also still can pack quite a lot of wallop yet, a lot of heat, a lot of things. But memories, they can't take away. I've watched interviews that they've done with prisoners and different things where people have been caught up and thrown in prison for the gospel or whatever. But there's one thing bars and chains and all that could never take away, and that's a person's memory. COVID-19 may steal a lot of things away from us, but one thing it can't steal is the good and the bad, but the things that we've lived in the past. Zachary was showing me a lot of photos on Facebook of Troy Fair's past and people that I recognize and shows and different things that had happened. Interesting things. But many times my thoughts go to things that you can eat. And I thought about the old days in the Wetona church days. August was ice cream social month. Big event. Some of you may have even attended them years ago. Starting out at the Wright, Pete Polly Wright's house, got too big for that. And they moved on to the churchyard and just all kinds of things. But I can remember folks gathering at Grandma Jackson's place and cranking up ice cream. In those days, when I was a kid, they still had the crank. Well, they gave me the job of cranking one or two. Grandma always said, when it begins to feel just a little bit hard to turn. Now, with an electric one, it's harder because you got to listen to that motor and everything. She says, I got some stuff I want to put in. Usually, it was either grape nuts or some kind of berries or bananas or something. But it had to be just right. I always kind of got the job of licking the paddle, but I had to be careful to grab the paddle quick because they'd scrape as much as they could off before I got it. Grandma's cellar was pretty chilly. It was about 55 or 60 in there during a hot July day, so it was a nice place to be. You could be in an AM hour doing something else. But she would always say, now, don't take the cover off till Grandma gets there. I would unlatch the crank and the gear drive and set it off to the side. One time I did lift the cover, and I quickly put it back down. Well, as you know, there's always ice, brine, salt. And I lifted the cover off. There's a little bit of salt and water and brine got in. Got it back on there. So Grandma added the ingredients. cranked her down good and we began to eat it. She always sampled it too. I had a lot more quality control time than she did, but she had to make the final. And she goes, "Did you take the cover off of Grandma's?" I said, "Yeah, I did." "Ah, it's ruined. Just a little bit of salt in that ice cream and it was like that." And Grandma's ice cream was always good. Mom's ice cream was always good. So being a good grandma like she was, "Oh, well, Grandma's going to have to make a new one. You're just going to have to crank." Well, it just meant another hour and a half or so, and Grandma's a nice, cool cellar. But just a little bit of salt just went right through that whole canister of mix. And I could eat a lot of things, as Zach knows, but I couldn't eat salty ice cream. It just wouldn't go. And then there was the potato salad that Mom used to make for those. She'd make them in these huge bowls for people. Again, I got the quality control. Stirring in, stirring that. Mom says, "Look out for eggshells." I can remember one time. I don't know how they got in there, but there was eggshells throughout the thing. And I tried picking them out. She says, "No, that ain't gonna work." And she wouldn't let it go. It was good tasting, but what's the lot? A little extra fodder, or whatever you want to call it, fiber. So she made a new batch. And that's the way they were. It had to be good. It had to be perfect. I still make a little of that today. Those candy helps me prep all the things. I had all the ingredients because it's right up here. Haven't made it in a long time. But it's amazing how even with that, you get to stir in the egg and you stir in everything and put in a little salt in it. Too much, you can't take it out, and a little bit goes a long ways and can have great effects. And I'm sure no chef, I'm no cook. I've done a little bit with the help of others and watched how a little bit can go a long way in a detrimental kind of way or in a good way. You get that potato salad or your favorite dish, whatever it might be, and you get it right there, and just that little additional spice or whatever it is, and you know what to do. I'm always amazed that, you know, Tammy, she's a like my grandmother was. Don't even look at a recipe, just I don't know how they do it. But just a little bit too much or not enough can make it good or can make it bad. The same recipe. We have a bulk tank in the milk house. That's the place for it. And on top of the bulk tank is a motor and a gearbox which drives a shaft and a big paddle on the bottom of the agitator that stirs the milk. 5 minutes every hour, all the time when you're milking. And our agitator is getting a little bit bad in the top and it starts to drizzle a little grease down the shaft. So we wipe it off. And I remember our milk inspector telling us even one drop of grease in that milk and it floats. And the load is no good. So, just one little batch of grease, one little drop of grease. Now, you might be able to scoop it out, but you don't know. A little bit can turn that load of milk to very bad. And you'd have to pull the plug. As long as we're in the cow mood, what about feeding those cows? You say a cow will eat anything. Many years ago, we were doing a feed program, and we were getting the feed ground from the feed mill, and they would deliver it in a truck. The guy says, "You need some more MAGOX, magnesium oxide. We're just going to put this little, I can't even remember what amount it was, but so much per ton, that's how they always do feed. You'll never know. If you've ever worked with cows, the feed was delivered. You feed them by hand with a metal spoon, we put it down. And that time we had about 60-some cows. Only three of them actually ate it. The rest of them wouldn't even take a lick. Just for a test, we had enough to feed them once in the corner because it's the old walk-in wooden granary like the old times. It isn't the metal upright. So we swept that other stuff into the middle of the manger and got them some of the old and put it down. Made it right on. So we called them up and they took the feed back and honored it because it was Feed Rep's program, and got the other stuff back out. We had to take the Magox out. They might have said they needed Magox, but they wouldn't need it. And they were smart. Just a little bit was enough. Fussy. Adam and Eve in the garden. Don't eat of the tree, the Lord said. All right? And you have to remember all the things that they had in the Garden of Eden. There wasn't anything they lacked. Everything was perfect. God creates things and it's perfect. There was no disease, no hot places, nothing. You didn't freeze to death. Food was always there. They had everything. Perfect health. 12 trees with fruit, one every month for the healing. So they never got sick, they never died. Satan comes along, the old serpent, and says, there's one thing you don't have. Isn't that just like us? We can have all these things, and yet there's one or two things that we don't have. It just really bugs us. We really ought to have that. Eat it, go ahead. You're going to be better off for it. You're going to know a whole lot more, I guarantee it. And you fell for it. Then it was just a little bite, not a big deal. Pick up your Bible and read the immediate post events that occurred, and then you can read on through the rest of the Bible, or you can read any world history all the way back to what's going on today. Because of that little bitty bite, this is what we're dealing with in a world of sin. Hatred, crime, wars, and there's no use of me even going through the list. You know what I'm talking about. Everything that you don't like, maybe there's a disease affecting you or someone you love or know, anything. Hot days, thistles in the backyard, thorn bushes. I remember one of the biggest things when we were renovating that pasture, we started out with a tractor doing things. And the thorns would go through the front tires and they were always flat. So at that time, I still had a bulldozer. So I only went over there with that. Nasty things. If you ever log off a section of woods for the next 5 years when you go through deer hunting, the picker bushes are like this. Yeah, you go through and you go through. I'll watch on the outside. And they'll come out after they get done. I'll walk. You know, you can see them in there. The deer love it. And it's amazing how quickly thorns and pickers reappear. Just a little bit. Just a little. But on the other hand, just a little bit of good can make so much difference. I was looking a little bit about Martin Luther here a while back. It was just a little book that I have, and it happened to kind of roll up on my desk. And so I leafed it, you know, open a little bit. And Martin Luther, of course, was hundreds of years ago. He was the author and the seed for the Reformation when the Protestant Church broke away from the Roman Catholic Church. But the greater focus here is it was also a pandemic and a plague in the time in which he lived. And it was far more serious than we've seen here with this one, and yet it occurred. No medicines, nothing. It was a very pagan society in which he lived. The thing that brought people around to Christianity in that time and brought us out of those Middle Ages was the fact that the people who called themselves Christians were able to go out and do things. They didn't take reckless chances, but they went out and they helped, and they would give just that little bit to their neighbor and their friend, and they witnessed it. We don't do that, the pagans would say. Or even in the Roman culture, they didn't do that. You got the black plague, you got what? That's just too bad. Shove them off in the hole. Throw a little lime on them and go on. Don't worry about the rest of it. They'll survive. But the Christians of that day, persecuted as they were, would continue to go out and help and witness and help and witness. And the people would begin to lock into that. Just a little bit. And time and again, people will say, all I have is a little bit. I don't have many talents. I don't have much money. Really fool myself. If you drop just a little bit of good somewhere, wherever it is. You ever have an old squeaky hinge or a squeaky bearing or something? All it's calling for is a drop or two of oil. I don't know about you, not a lot of things bother me, but something bothers me about a door, like in your house, like, so I've got some that if you move them fast, they don't do it, but if you leave them open and they just kind of slowly, the wind or whatever, like that, I'll go get the WD-40 or something to put on it. You don't need very much, do you? And the good that it does. A little bit of leaven affects the whole lump. Now, I've never made any bread. I haven't got into that. But I do know that there's leavened bread, there's unleavened bread. The Bible refers to the leaven as being bad, and that's why they have the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. Not bad for you and I as Gentiles and the new. But just a little bit of leaven affects the whole loaf, doesn't it? A little bit of sin can wreck the whole thing. John Deere A, middle of the summer, many years ago, coming back up through the Wetona Road with the ray gun. I guess. It wasn't me, it was driving it. And I wasn't around, but later we were dealing with the consequences, and the individual that came along said, can they help? My dad is driving it. I said, yeah, there's a can of gas up in the white shop we have up near the road. Just grab that and down will be good. Well, I don't know what he was thinking. Probably was the heat or whatever, but the guy brought down the chainsaw gas and poured a couple gallons. And it ran probably from here to the monument. Boom, boom. Smoke came out of it. That was it. I remember coming back up from the other place down on Ringler Road, and I see it sitting along the road, nobody around. They told me the story, and so we grabbed a chain, we pulled it back up, had to drain the tanks, new spark plugs in, put good gas in, and tow it around some more. But all because that gasoline had just a little bit of oil that you mix with the gas, created all that trouble. A little bit of water in the gas will do the same thing. Wintertime, it'll freeze up on you. But I think the last example I like best, because it's back to food and good things to drink. You take a nice glass of white milk. Now, I'm not a big milk drinker, I'll admit to that. But when I was a kid, in a bottle, then it was a tin can of Hershey's syrup. You know, the kind where you had to punch the hole in it with a can opener, had the little top that came off. You pour just a little bit in and you watch it, that nice white milk, and it begins to go down in there and stir and mix through, and soon the milk's got a little chocolate color. The kind that brown Swiss and Jerseys get, right? Holsteins we had to add. It's the gospel truth, no. And I'd pour a little more in because I liked it rich, and Mom said, that's enough. No, that's enough. Then she'd grab it, and I'd like to stir it up. Nice, dark chocolate. Yeah, that was good. And a little bit of it went a long way in changing the color of that milk. And I'm glad you weren't totally asleep, and that brought you out. That's no laugh. But I'm going to close with those points again. A little good or a little bad. A little bit of sin in the garden wrecked the entire mankind and society. And yet God said, no, I'm going to offer an alternative. I'm going to bring you back if you'll come to me. And that's what church is all about. That's what the ministry is all about. That's what Christianity is all about. If you receive that gift, that free gift, just a little bit of good going out. From you personally, as a group here, a little bit of good can affect so much. And that's what our focus really wants to be. Just remember that. It doesn't take much sometimes. a little bit. Sometimes just a plate of chocolate chip cookies, especially if Tammy made them and they're fresh, mm-hmm. and you're delivering them, and you're tempted to eat them after you've already sampled on the way over. It's hard. We used to go on these picnics, and Mom would have all that food in the trunk, and it would waft up through into the back seat as a kid. I said, how much further do we got to go? We're almost there. Man, I couldn't wait. Just a little bit. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads for a word of prayer. Father, we do praise you for the blessing of the day again. There's warmth in this place, the uncomfortable kind, and yet you have created us in a way that we can deal with it. But in a greater way, and in a better way, and something we should really consider, there is spiritual warmth in this place. And outside in this world, there is spiritual darkness and coldness, hatred and fear, sickness and disease, and the list goes on. We know that you are above all that and that you're fully capable of taking care of any of it. It would be very easy for us to just walk away and say, let God take care of it. It's too much for me. And yet, you throw it right back at us. For we are your hands and your feet, your arms, your eyes and your ears, your body. And as the song goes, if we are the body, then why aren't we moving and doing even more than we already are? Help us to remember that just a little bit of bad can cause a whole lot of consequences. But a little bit of good, on the other hand, can end up causing so much good as it ripples through and it grows and expands. Help us to consider these things today as we read your word. Bless those who are absent again. Bless those who have received this word that they would consider it, read it, go over it again and again. And help them to be the givers who will let out just that little bit, or even a lot. And as the expansion goes, that we can all witness. And one day when we stand before your throne, and you will say to each of us, well done, faithful servant. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 5:16 is our closing.